See, today we are going into a slightly difficult
area of tracking the difference between how the people-state relationship evolved in Europe, which is the basis for the entire Western model, and how it evolved in India. Unless we are clear about this difference, it will not be possible for us to grasp the difference between the economic, business, financial and behavioral model in the West as compared to India. See, the West has a very autogenous model. Autogenous means that it develops its own historical way of progressing from where it was to where it is now. It cannot be replicated anywhere else in the world, because that has been achieved as a tremendous human cost of 1 billion lives. It is not possible to have that kind of experiment anywhere, except to the extent, some extent in China, in the in its entire history, and Russia in the 20th century. Nowhere else such killings have taken place in the world, including Japan. Japan has killed outside, it has not killed inside Japan. So it is a very peculiar history. Unless we understand that history, how the whole theory of state evolved and how it affected the people, we will not be able to understand how the hyper-individualism developed in the West. Individualism in the West is a product of first religious oppression, then oppression by the state, then revolt by the people. The people had to revolt for freedom, for their property, for their life, for their speech, they had to revolt. So it was a question of ideological tussle. In fact, the ideology in the West has nothing like that similar in this country. So unless we understand that, we will not be able to grasp how changes in the state people relationship took place in the West. You know, first it was the divine right theory, about which I mentioned briefly yesterday, that the king on this earth, he rules on behalf of God outside the earth. So he had all the rights. That is why the king can do no wrong principle applied in the Western constitutionalism and applies even today. The concept that king can do no wrong is a reflection that king reflects God on the earth. So that was a very important point of tussle between the state and the church. The church claimed that right, the king also claimed that right. That is how the tussle occurred, and that led to separation of the church from the state. It is within the same faith. You must understand, in Europe, secularism meant not more than one religion. Secularism meant division of powers within the same religion, church and state. There was no multi-religious situation like in India. There is no sarva-dharma samabhava, no. The same book, the same God, the same worship, but still the king has his role and the church has its role. We must understand the evolution of secularism in this. You cannot apply the same principle here. There, then status became anti-God, and that is how churches have declined. It is a tussle. You cannot replicate it in any other place outside Christendom. We must understand that if we have to understand how the social contract theory evolved. You know, social contract theory evolved, this is actually Thomas Hobbes who theorized social contract. See, the king ruled by divine right. Thomas Hobbes said, no, there is a contract between the people and the king by which all the rights, liberties, and the powers of the people are vested in the state, because by this time there has been an evolution that the king is state, is not just the king. That consciousness was developing, and the people's powers are assumed by the state or the king without their consent. This was the principle, what was called Leviathan. Leviathan is the very powerful instrument sitting on the people. It is the people's own interest, otherwise there will be chaotic. The natural tendency of the people is to be anarchic, and a state is needed to restore order. And so the by a contract, social contract, without the consent of the people, all the rights, liberties, property rights, right to life, everything is vested in the state or the king. This was Hobbes' theory. Then Locke, he said, no, this happens with consent. This is where democracy came. Without consent was totalitarianism. With consent was democracy. This is how, from divine right to social contract to democratic social contract principle evolved in the West. It is a tussle. In every one of these transitions, there have been huge bloodshed. 100 years of war, 30 years of war. You must see the list of wars in Wikipedia. You need not have to go anywhere. You will find enormous amount of bloodshed. It was not just mere intellectual debate or discourse or arguments like Adi Shankara and Mandana Mishra. It never happened. They don't know it. So this transition, which was concerning the state and people relationship, transmuted into how the people will relate to each other. This is state people, this is people to people. How people to people will relate? By that time, industrial revolution had occurred. After industrial revolution, the neighborhood societies have got disturbed, villages have been disturbed. And you must have read those poems of Wordsworth and all that, where is my shopkeeper, where is my vegetable vendor, I'm missing him. You know, this a personalized society became impersonalized because of the intervention of industrial revolution. And these people were trying to define how the relationships have changed. You don't know who is going to be your vendor. There's a huge shop, you go and buy, some employee sells, you don't know. Now it is Levi's, now it is Walmart. It's a, you are dealing with a brand, you are not dealing with a person. The seeds were laid in that there is a difference between how people related before the Industrial Revolution and people related to each other after the Industrial Revolution. This was theorized by Spencer. First, he said the relationship between the people was military, because it was ordered relationship, like the social contract, Leviathan, you have to be like this. So it was, relation was a military kind of relationship. And post Industrial Revolution, it became industrial relation. Workers of steel industry, workers of cotton industry, that is how they began relating. This was one theory. The second theory was by Mayne. Mayne is important because sometime later, if I have the time, I will deal with you. The man came to India, he worked in India, and he theorized the relation in a traditional society is based on status. Spencer said it is based on military relationship. One man says this is how it has to be, village headman or whatever, and everybody behaves accordingly. Here it became status. Father, son, some community leader and the community followers. Is it? It is status oriented relationship, brother and sister, this is status. Then he said it becomes contract. It is contractual relationship that will prevail in an impersonalized society, but he never anticipated that contract will enter the family also. He was only visualizing a broad people's relationship, and this became later the basis of Western anthropology. And this Max Weber and later Karl Popper, they refined it and married it to market economics, saying that there is no relationship between people except by choice. The word choice became the watchword or the only guiding principle of people relationship. If you have a choice of having a relationship with husband and wife relationship, between husband and wife, it extended to father and son, it extended to everybody. With the result, there is no defined relationship or a relationship which is outside choice. Every relationship became choice. So what became contract by Western anthropological model, where the traditional societies are disturbed, new relationships come, the new relationships are purely contract. That is how it descended into, there is nothing called a society, everybody is a collection of individuals. If you want to study a society, you have to study the individuals. It is not that you study the society and look at the individual. This is where completely the West went wrong, because they disturbed the society. There was no social organism. Without a social organism, you cannot study why an individual behaves like this. You have to study why the civil society behaves like this by looking at individuals. So you take samples, and in the samples, out of say 5 million people, you take 500 samples, random sampling, all these principles develop, and you, these 500 people behave which way, the 5 million people behave that way. It is the reductionism that followed by this process of making people unrelated to each other, because in West very largely this unrelation took place because of the disturbance to the traditional society, which was based only on neighborhood. If the neighborhood was disturbed, there was no other relationship. In fact, linguistic relationship was also not there. Many of us do not know. I will advise you to read Arun Shori's book on secular agenda as to how state in the West evolved. He extensively dealt with Hobsbawm, who recently died last year. He was a Marxist thinker. He was the one who wrote how the states evolved, modern states evolved in the West, and the conclusion he reached was the modern states, nation state as we call, is as recent as the 18th, 19th century. Before that, there was no concept of nation state. There was a state without a nation. There was a nation without a state. But the concept of nation state evolved only in the 18th and 19th centuries, according to Hobsbawm. Arun Shori has dealt with beautifully in that book I would like you to read. It's just about 4 or 5 articles, but brilliantly capturing how this entire social contract theory worked itself out as nation state. Even language, which is the basis of France, for instance, when France was conceived as a state, less than 3% or 2.5% of the so-called French people knew the French language. It is a mighty group of people who bet others and shaped them into a nation. Like, for instance, Italy. When the modern Italy was founded, Italian language was not the medium of instruction or medium of intercourse. It was a very small percentage of Italians who spoke Italian language. It is that other things which made it possible for them to be shaped into a nation state. It's very, very beautifully explained. So you must understand the social contract and individual contract, how through Western anthropological model has now worked itself to a completely individualistic aggregation into a nation and a state without any kind of relationship, without choice. You have no choice about certain relationship. that is non-contractual. You are not consenting to be the son of a mother. You can acknowledge your mother or you need not acknowledge your mother is the basis of Max Weber descending into Carl Weber, and that is what has now resulted in 55% of the first marriages ending in divorce, 67% of the second marriages, 74% of the third marriages ending in divorce, 41% of the babies being born outside wedlock, 51% of the family is having father and the mother not living together. This is the progress. Now, in Germany, there is a principle called Gemeinschaft, where people relate to each other, and Gesellschaft, where people have a legal contractual relationship. And this is where the most important thing came. A man who was completely ignored, a man called Emil Durkheim. Emil Durkheim, this is a triangle. Adam Smith, Karl Marx, Emil Durkheim. We have to study all three of them together if we have to understand modern Western economics. Otherwise, we cannot understand modern Western economics, how from classicalism it went into neoclassical modern economics, and what is the contribution of Karl Marx, what is the contribution of Adam Smith, with virtually no contribution from Durkheim. Durkheim wrote, first we will take Wealth of Nations of Adam Smith. Adam Smith never visualized in 1776. He wrote Wealth of Nations in 1776. He never visualized a society would be disturbed. He only thought that there would be guilds forming and there would be specialization, mass production, and increased efficiency, and the market will be the mechanism by which supply and demand will be related in terms of price, which he called as the invisible hand. This was the theory he formed, but he founded his theory on functioning societies, because it was never visualized at that time that the progress or the drift in the Western society will lead to the extinction of the society itself. That was not the position. So Adam Smith founded his market theory, which was based on people who are rationally interested in their own actions, their own destinies, selfish individuals acting in self-interest will collectively promote collective interest. That was the principle of Adam Smith's market theory, which applies even today in neoclassical economics also, of course with huge differences as to what that self-interest means. Then Karl Marx, it's a reaction. Huge exploitation was there, and so Karl Marx theorized that this Western capitalism is going to collapse. This new capitalism which has arisen is going to collapse, and ultimately it is the proletariat, the worker, who actually produces, and it is he who transforms natural resources into usable goods, and the only thing that should be added to the cost of the natural resources is the wages. Everything else is only a fake earning by a class power. And so he advocated the collapse of capitalism, if need be, through revolution. Revolution was not implicit in Karl Marx theory. In fact, Karl Marx postulated for a society to progress, capitalism is necessary. Capitalism will build a society, and then capitalism will collapse under its own weight, because it cannot bear the kind of profit element that comes into it. It cannot be borne by society, and ultimately capitalism will fail. And then Lenin transformed it, say it has to be with the unity of the proletariat to overthrow the capitalist order. And this theory was written, the Communist Manifesto was written in 1848. It's almost 170 years after Karl Marx. It's about 72 years after Karl Marx, Adam Smith. And in 67 only the first volume of Das Kapital was published, and the second and third volumes were published after Karl Marx's demise. The third volume was published after Karl Marx's demise. So these two persons shared the same idea of people to people relationship as purely contractual. The theory that evolved was purely, once you promote a selfish individual, Adam Smith ought to have known that he will have choices. The element of choice overrules anything which is not based on choice. Relationships are not based on choice. Once that element came, the implicit in the Wealth of Nations is a contract based relationship between people. And so Adam Smith and Karl Marx shared the same thing. How it later resulted in what is known as social engineering. The social engineering is change in the relationship of the people. In capitalism, it happens through market. In socialism, it happens through state. The social engineering is the basis of, for transformation of the individual into choice based people. The only thing is here the choice is individual, it is collectivized. To that extent there is no individual choice. All have to be like this. All have to have contract based association. It is a collective decision, and then the party, then the state, then commune, shared living, and 20 families must use one toilet. You know, this is the kind of communism meant, community living, but in new community. It is not an old community. Everything old has to be discarded because the society doesn't look at history. It only looks forward in history. The forward movement of history that that shaped the communist order. In this great man, he wrote a book. The name of the book is Division of Labor in Society. This book was written in 1893. It was translated into English sometime in 1930, I think. Till then the world did not know about it. 1933. He said, between the state and the individual, you cannot have a void. This is the greatest contribution M.L. Durkheim made to the Western thinking. This man is a Scot, is a German, is a French. Almost around the same time, except that he predated Karl Marx and M.L. Durkheim. Related almost at the same time, M.L. Durkheim did not come into being till the distortions of capitalism began to manifest in the world in the 1990s. At that time, Francis Fukuyama, who wrote that famous book End of History and Lost Man, which said that what Hegel had promised. Hegel said there will be fight between thesis and antithesis, and there will be synthesis. This is how he formulated thesis, antithesis, synthesis. This became the He says this is the model by which the tussles in the society will work themselves out. First there is thesis A, then antithesis B, then synthesis C. Then he says synthesis will become the thesis, and some other antithesis will develop, that is D, and there will be a synthesis, that is E, and then that E synthesis will become the antithesis. He said the ideological pendulum will keep moving this way and that way. Ultimately, there will be a perfect society. This is what he postulated, and Karl Marx adopted. And it's a very, in fact, it's a very, very interesting discussion if you can go into. as to how Hegelian theory was adopted by both believers and non-believers, by both capitalists as well as Marxists, and to say ultimately there will be a perfect society through state which is formed out of a revolution where there will be no difference, there will be no discrimination. That is the Marxist view. Capitalist view is through market and social engineering through market there will be prosperity spread and there will be perfect in conjunction with democracy, freedom. And so first Francis Fukuyama wrote End of History. This book is dated 1992. He said this tussle of thesis, antithesis, synthesis is gone, and the last tussle was between capitalism and communism, and that has ended. That means free market mechanism and liberal democracy of the West have won once and for all. So the West has emerged as the winner, and the rest is finally defeated, and free market mechanism and liberal democracy constitute what Hegel and Marx wanted as the perfect society with the state matching it, though it was not through what Marx wanted. This is how he concluded. The end of history means end of all conflicts. In 1992 he visualized globalization means the end of all conflicts. You must understand how the whole process of tussle and tussle and tussle moved. By globalization it was concluded as the end of all conflicts. We have reached a state of perfect society in which there is a perfect state, there is a perfect market and everything. This was the view as a result of globalization. Now after 3 years Francis Fukuyama completely revises his opinion in the book called The Trust. I think this book has been suggested to you. I won't like you to read the whole. First 50-60 pages are sufficient. It's a brilliant discussion as to how a man who felt that a perfect society has been reached through liberal democracy and free market finally went to M.L. Durkheim. M.L. Durkheim said previous society was a mechanical society. The new society is an organic society. In an organic society, things evolve. As a result of industrialism, your new society evolves. It is not that collection of individuals without relation among them evolve. It is only legal relation or contractual relation. There is an emotional content to the relationship, and he said that that will be a relation based society. This is the most critical element, and M.L. Durkheim theorized like this: the relationship between the people and the state through the society. It is not the absence of society, through the society. He says a society composed of an infinite number of unorganized individuals. Why I am mentioning this is the entire market theory is based on this. Atomized individuals unconnected to one another, there is no relationship. It is a matter of choice, self-interest, rational market theory, efficient market theory, gaming theory, everything evolved out of it. If there is a relationship between the people, market theory will not work. Market theory works only when people have complete choice. If there is no freedom of choice which overrides any other bondage, then market theory will not work. At least in theory it will not work. In practice it's a different thing. Even in the West there is still relationship, and that still makes the market imperfect. So now he says a society composed of an infinite number of unorganized individuals, that a hypertrophied state is forced to oppress and contain. That was the position in the West. The state always sat on the people. For example, there is a principle called eminent domain. the eminent domain principle is that everything belongs to God and therefore everything belongs to the king, and the king can assume anything which he wants, and the only thing is because the land belongs to God, the property belongs to God, you belong to God, your life belongs to God, and so everything belongs to king. This is the divine right theory. So when this democratic consciousness, people's rights consciousness evolved, they modified it. That is the eminent domain. Though you are a tenant or a leaseholder or license holder of your land, of your life, of your other properties, the king can assume it and pay you some compensation. This is considered to be one of the fundamental rights. In India, it is not recognized. Till the British came, the eminent domain principle was not applicable in India. In fact, the Supreme Court held that it was never applicable in India, and it is the Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence which made it applicable in India, because land acquisition in India was not possible if you applied the Indian law. In Indian law, the king and the people both had rights in the land, but you could never deprive the people of their rights because they have to cultivate, they have to eat, and in fact cultivable land could never be taken over by the king. In fact, the king's right was limited to properties which he purchased with the consent of the people. This is the position in our Dharma Shastras. Quoting this, the Supreme Court said there is nothing called divine right in this country. But the argument of Niren Day during the emergency, that all the rights of the people are vested in the state and the state could suspend the rights and kill the people, was based on the divine right theory, social contract theory, and the model of the West, which never applied in this country. You can understand the difference. The difference is not theoretical. The difference is the state and people relationship, whether there is an intermediation of the society, culture, values, tradition, morality, all these things come into being. Nothing matters when you have only state and people or state and individuals. A hypertrophied state is forced to oppress and contain, constitute a veritable sociological monstrosity. The sociological monstrosity is there in both. It is through the state, here it is through institutions. And he says, moreover, a state is too remote from individuals. Its relations with them too external, too intermittent to penetrate deeply into individual consciousness and socialize them within. The state by law cannot regulate people. By law, you cannot build relationship between people. You can separate people. Can you make husband and wife to live together through law? You can separate them by law. You cannot make families to work together by law, but you can have a partition suit to separate the families. So the state can do only dividing work. Politics can do only dividing work. It is only wisdom, great people who can only build values and keep people together. It is not the art of state. It is not the art of statecraft. Social craft is needed. You have to rise above power. That is what has sustained the Indian society, most of the Eastern society. It is the absence of it that has disturbed the Western society. So M.L. Durkheim says this completely wrong. Don't go into this path. A nation can be maintained only if between the state and the individuals there is interposed a whole series of secondary groups near enough to the individual to attract them strongly to their sphere of action and drag them in this way into the general torrent of social life. Occupational groups are best suited to fill this role, and that is their destiny. This is how he advocates building of guilds and relating people within, and people socialize and relate within and become bound by a culture of their own, a new culture which evolves apart from the mechanical. Then you are in a village, you are in a village, that's all you know, but you have to develop a culture which binds all tradesmen, all kinds of people. But he says occupational group lawyers, they have a very limited way of organizing themselves through their profession. So like that, he said, that organic society will evolve, and without that organic society you cannot even have contracts which will be working. This is the most important thing. Even for the contracts to work, there has to be relationship between the people, and without the relationship between the people, only social contract and contracts by choice cannot make a society function. That was Emile Durkheim's theory. In 1995, Francis Fukuyama, who wrote End of History and Last Man, he said conflicts are all over, market has prevailed, democracy has prevailed, Hegel has come into being, Marx is realized. He wrote the book Trust, and you must read only the first few pages. It's a very interesting debate, because this man created a consternation when he wrote this book Trust. After writing End of History, there was a debate in America. Now this means the end of economics. This is the title. You understand, if you say society is there, there is no economics, or economics of the current understanding. So you must understand where a society has its own way of dealing. Interpersonal relationships, which are far superior to any contract, inherited, where people work as immediately relating to each other, then a different socio-economic model will result. That's Germany, that's Japan, that is Korea, Taiwan, and that's China, and you must understand that's India. You can never belong to this social engineering structure, and social engineering is the foundation of both capitalism and communism. Communism does it through revolution and state, and capitalism does it through individualism and market choices. And see what Fukuyama says on this. And he is a man who, a very clear advocate of market economics, but he is not an advocate of market society. It's very important. A society can have a market within, but it cannot be substituted by market. You understand? The market principle of choice should not enter the domain of the society and the domain of the family. You have no choice in certain matters. Once you recognize choice is there everywhere, then you are converting market economics into market society. That doesn't apply even in America. There are people who still believe Bible is right, and they don't use chemicals, and they have agriculture which was followed 2000 years back in Jerusalem, and they live and they ignore the modern society. They don't go in, it is there, but it is an anecdotal example. But the vast universal rule, it's all choice, it's all individualistic, and that has produced a model also, right up to in England by 2015 you will have 51% of the babies being born for unwed mothers. This is the output of social engineering based on individualism, contract, and no interpersonal relationships except by choice. Now he now says why I wrote this and why I am writing this. The convergence of institutions around the model of democratic capitalism, however, has not meant an end to society's challenges. Within a given institutional framework, societies can be richer or poorer, or have more or less satisfying social and spiritual lives. But a corollary to the convergence of institution at the end of history is the widespread acknowledgement that in pre-industrial societies, further industrial improvements cannot be achieved through the ambitious social engineering. We no longer have realistic hope that we can create a great society through large government programs. Because after the fall of communism, even during the existence of communism, capitalism adjusted itself through the welfare state concept. And once the government began to undertake the responsibilities of the people, communism had nothing to do, because the state itself began practicing what is known as the state capitalism. Obama is an example of state capitalism, state socialism. So now he says that is now coming to an end. The state is no more able to undertake these obligations. The Clinton administration's difficulties in promoting healthcare reform in 1994 indicated Americans remained skeptical about the workability of large-scale government management of an important sector of their economy. You know, when Clinton came, he constituted a group to go into privatization of health insurance, health security. And they came to the conclusion it has to be privatized. They came to the conclusion it cannot be privatized, because it can be privatized only if there is a relationship between the people. If the son will take care of the father, the parents will take care of the children. If this relationship is disturbed, you cannot privatize the social security or health insurance, with the result what the state cannot do, it has disabled the society from doing. The state took over all this, disabled the society, made the family, society functionless, and now it finds it cannot privatize it, because from where, from whom it took over, they have forgotten their moral, cultural, spiritual, filial obligations. You cannot create it, you can destroy it. So the Clinton administration came to the conclusion health insurance has to be privatized. Today the biggest problem of America is health insurance. You know, the social security and health insurance costs will eat away the entire American revenue. Entire. There will be no money even to pay salary to the President of the United States of America by 2048, unless they are going to do it. By 2019, the health insurance may face bankruptcy, because once you promote these schemes, you can never withdraw it. You make people functionless, you make people less responsible. In fact, Milton Friedman said, I can understand you giving this facility to people who need it. You have given it facilities to all. And so you don't even have examples of people who take care of their parents. You legislate, you need not take care of their parents. You make a society forget its social obligation. You make the example so clear, when parents are being taken care of by the state, they don't respect their children. Okay, who are you? Clinton will take care of me. The children also say, who are you? Clinton will take care of me. This is what Milton said, that this is what you are doing. You are making the people to forget and delegitimize, trivialize time-honored obligations which have only sustained humanity. And you call it economics, and you call it forward-looking economics. You call it as the way towards which the world should be moving, which Alan Greenspan said, we have a very enlightened government. We take care of the people. We take care of all their needs. But it is only societies which cannot do it, states which cannot do it. They are saddled with the obligation of having to take care of their parents, elders, infirm people, and so they have to save. Our society need not save. Can you find a more reckless economics as the output of all these processes by which the state-people relationship is changed? Now, Fukuyama comes to why he is now changing his conclusion, just 3 years. He understood the problems of globalization, how it is bringing artificial prosperity to the West, how it will not last. He says, so further improvements cannot be achieved through the ambitious social engineering. We no longer have realistic hopes that we can create great society with large government programs. The Clinton administration, in Europe, almost no one argues that the continent's major concerns today, such as high continuing rate of unemployment or immigration, can be fixed through expansion of a welfare state. If anything, reform agenda consists cutting back the welfare state to make the European industry more competitive on a global basis, even in Keynesian deficit financing. Once widely used by industrial democracies after the Great Depression to manage a business cycle, is today regarded by most economists as self-defeating in the long run. But that has become regular economics today. What Keynes said is a medicine to be administered when a man is in fits. If a man is in fits once in 5 years or once in 3 years, you can administer that medicine. But if he is in fits every day, that is what has happened today. Keynes has become a Keynesian model has become the regular model of all societies. What is going to happen in the long run is not the issue. What is going to happen day after tomorrow is the issue today. As I said, in the last 4 years, from 2008-9 onwards, the Europe, America, and now Japan has joined the club. They have printed $5.4 trillion, just paper money. Keep on printing, and this is called Abenomics in Japan, because when somebody prints it and you don't print, you are at a disadvantage. So it is colonization through currency. I have written an article in Business Line, you can access it, how currency has become the instrument of colonization. It is all deterritorialized currencies. Ours is a territorial currency. Most currencies are territorial. China's currency is territorial. It's a powerful economy, but its currency cannot be deterritorialized except at the cost of China. But once you are a deterritorialized currency, you circulate outside your territory, you can print currency and export that currency without inflation here, buy goods, and the other man has your IOU. And that is called your foreign exchange reserve. This perversion called economics is now working itself out. No one knows where it will end, when it will end, after the end what. So now Fukuyama says, even Keynesian deficit spending, once widely used by industrial democracies after Great Depression to manage a business cycle, is today regarded by most economists as self-defeating in the long run. These days, the highest ambition of most governments in their macroeconomic policy is to do no harm by ensuring stable money supply and controlling large budget deficit. This is the contribution of Alan Greenspan, that you keep on increasing money supply, but you ensure that there is no inflation. Money supply means inflation, but they decided not to have inflation, for which they began importing goods, exporting the currencies. So they made other countries need their currency for their reserves and their markets to promote employment in them. China kept on importing and getting American dollars in return. It is saddled with $3 trillion of American currency. What it will do with it? Now praying for America's welfare. So this economics is not going to work. This Fukuyama realized. Today, having abandoned the promise of social engineering, most important, communism is not there. Capitalism has also abandoned the concept of social engineering. I'll come to it later. Huge rethinking is taking place, but they cannot speak it out. It is like something they know it's going to happen, still they cannot speak it out. And European Union has circulated a paper as to how the traditional society has changed, how new obligations are coming. It's a discussion paper. Where are we going? We must realize it. This is the new paper which they are circulating. But once you have debased that thought, once you have made the individual an unbridled liberated person or a woman, they are not going to go back to any restriction. A restraint is self-imposed. Supervised by the elders, supervised by the family, supervised by the society. You remove all these constraints, why will the individual go back to self-restraint? Today, having abandoned the promise of social engineering, virtually all serious observers understand that liberal political and economic institutions depend on healthy and dynamic civil society for their vitality. You know, there is a huge difference between civil society and society. A civil society is what Durkheim talks as organic society. In the West, a Rotary Club is civil society. Industry association is civil society. A club is a civil society. But this is modernism trying to find some way of working together. And he says, even that is getting lost. And he goes further. Civil society, a complex welter of intermediate institutions, including businesses, voluntary associations, educational institutions, clubs, unions, media, charities, and churches, builds in turn on the family. This you don't voluntarily associate. A voluntary association of family can be voluntary dissolution of family. Unless there is a clear absence of choice in a family is not a stable institution. It is like a club. You can become a member, you can give up membership tomorrow. So he say, what he says as family is not in our sense the family. That family was no responsibility to the children. He says no, it must have responsibility. No, it will not have responsibility if it is voluntary. Unless you feel there is a duty element in this, what distinguishes all other associations and the family, all other associations are governed by rights, a family is governed by duty. Without a sense of duty, a family cannot be sustained. But that is not the area where Francis Fukuyama will step into. The latter, he stepped into it and got into all kinds of difficulties because that goes against the rights consciousness of the society, of the Western polity. Builds in turn on the family, the primary instrument by which people are socialized into their culture and given the skills that allow them to live within a broader society, and through which values and knowledge of that society are transmitted across generations. That is a continuity which no other instrument, no other institution, no other agency can perform that work. And you disturb it, destroy it, and where do you regenerate it? So this is the question before the entire modern West today. How to regenerate what they have destroyed? It is in archives. It is in the burial ground. A strong and stable family structure and durable social institution cannot be legislated into existence by way a government can create a central bank or an army. Fantastic statement. This is not coming from me. This is coming from a man recognized as a towering intellectual in the world, who wrote virtually the Bible of globalization, turned back upon it in 3 years, and coming to the same conclusion as you and me are experiencing. We cannot experience the worth of a family or natural relationship which forms the basis for a larger institutional arrangement unless you compare what we are and what the West is. And if you think you are going to be the West, you will be ruining like Francis Fukuyama, who is now trying to trace the origins of their family into cemeteries. A thriving civil society depends on a people's habits, customs, and ethics, and attributes that can be shaped only indirectly through conscious political action and must otherwise be nourished through an increased awareness and respect for culture. You can understand how the U-turn is taking place. The U-turn is taking place not out of realization. It is taking place as a result of the response to a desperate situation. Have you ever seen this discourse in India in any academic institution, sociological institution? Any social sociology department in India? This discourse is taking place in the West because they are facing a tough challenge. And are we to wait till the challenge comes here, or are we to avoid the challenge, is what we have to. You see, all of us owe this duty. You see, we are the beneficiaries of a civilizational assert which this country is owning. If you exhaust those civilizational assets like the West has done, West has exhausted its cultural and civilizational assets, and they have transformed Madonna as the example of the culture. Once you make Madonna as the brand ambassadors of the culture of a society, there is no culture. A different approach is needed, and that approach inheres here, that you trivialize as irrelevant, backward, unmodern, anti-modern. How many of us understand modernity means sexual revolution? Modernity is not dress, it is not just language, it is not just freedom of speech, it is irreverence. Modernity lacks reverence. There is a beautiful book written, I will bring it in the next class and quote it, as to how the West realizes modernity means lack of reverence. Take for instance education. In education there is no respect for teacher. You are supposed to call the teacher by first name. And if an Indian student goes from here, he stands up in the class when the teacher arrives, the teacher is shaken. Why is he standing? And there are 40 students from Asia and only 60 students from other places, if there are 100 students. These 40 students stand up reverentially. Then the professors are shocked. Then they are given counseling. Don't be shocked. Can you believe this? And they are counseled to overcome the shock, not counseled to appreciate this. So that author writes, modernity builds irreverence into human beings. This irreverence has a universal consequence. So Francis Fukuyama finally comes to the conclusion that family is important. But the concept of family he mentions is, you must, by choice, you must somehow continue. And nobody continues somehow by choice. There must be convention, there must be culture, there must be tradition, there must be social pressure, there must be counseling by family members, otherwise husband and wife are not going to live together for any longer than Americans or British people. So we must understand these are all very important civilizational assets. Unless we understand it that way, the way the West has progressed, the theory of the state based on social contract, the theory of the people to people relationship based on contracts and choices, which has led both through communism and capitalism. You should don't think communism and capitalism are opposing, warring ideologies. The only difference between capitalism and communism, I have argued this with many communists, is whether the property or the wealth should be owned by individuals or it should be owned by the collective state. I said it is a property dispute. Clearly. And people who own the property here, they purchase the property, their property is registered in their name. But in a communist setup, the property is owned by the district secretary. Whoever becomes the district secretary becomes the property owner. And he doesn't want to cease to be the district secretary. After him, his son becomes the district secretary. Communism has become hereditary. That is how most of the public sector undertakings were taken over by the party bosses. Property decided the owner there. Here the owner decided the property. That is not the difference. So we must understand that entire materialistic philosophy is founded on obsession with property. You must have a property transcending approach. That is culture, civilization, spiritualism, religion, family, natural sharing. That's what makes India take care of 60 crore people who are dependent on their near and dear for their existence. And it is not done as an obligation, it is done as a reverential duty. This is what Fukuyama says. You cannot legislate it by law. It is not related to modern economics, but it can completely destroy modern economics. So this is what we have to understand when we are talking about the Indian economic, business, financial management model, it is based on the Indian behavioral model, culturally, socially, spiritually, religiously. There is a different model which is functioning, where the choice of an individual is aligned, integrated, somewhat compromised by a trade-off with the individual's duties. This marks a different model, and that is what we are going to understand, how it has worked, because this issue requires a deeper consideration. I don't think in any economics class you will have a wide discussion of what I call as the helicopter view, a transdisciplinary approach as to how different disciplines interrelate, influence, but yet coexist, produce a converging consequence, good or bad, distorted or harmonious. You must understand that this is a very, very critical element which we have to. So I will just read out a couple of paragraphs from Francis Fukuyama. He compares the American situation as to how small industries have developed in America and how some communities are able to flourish and some are not. This is at page 10 of the book. Small business, the first thing is, first what I read out was at page 4. This is at page 10. You need to read only 7, 8, 10 pages in this book. Small businesses in American inner cities are seldom owned by African Americans. They tend to be controlled by other ethnic groups like the Jews earlier in the centuries and Koreans today. One reason is the absence of a strong community and mutual trust among the contemporary American underclass. They are related only by their color, nothing else. See how difficult it is. Korean businesses are organized around the stable families and benefit from rotating credit association. Mark these words. I am going to read out something else so that you can relate it to Tirupur. Korean businesses are organized around stable families and benefit from rotating credit associations within the broader ethnic community. Inner city African American families are weak and credit associations virtually non-existent. This has nothing to do with banks. This has nothing to do with government. It is that he belongs to my group and he starts a business. He needs help. I have to give. This is an obligation which the community relation creates, and it is widespread in India. Just to give you a small example, I said there are 43.2 million non-farming enterprises, which is supposed to have grown to 90 million now. 43.2 million non-farming enterprises in 2005. By 2015, they say it is, the census is going to start. It has started already. It will be 90 million. These 43.2 million non-farming enterprises employ 100 million people, and only 5% of the financial requirements are funded by banks and other organized financing like government or anything. 95% comes from credit rotation and funding mechanism within the community. Now he goes on to say, these cases reveal the absence of a proclivity for community that inhibits people from exploiting economic opportunities that are available to them. The problem is one of a deficit of what the sociologist James Coleman has called as social capital. This is a very important term. You must understand there are three kinds of capital: financial, intellectual, social. These two are individual assets. You own finance, you own property, you own everything. It belongs to you. Intellectual capital. You have brains, you are an engineer, you are a chartered accountant, you are a lawyer, you are a scientist, it belongs to you. Social capital belongs to the society. But every individual has to ensure that social capital exists. So everyone has to contribute to it. It is like a kamadhenu, as Lord Krishna said in Bhagavad Gita. He said this whole concept of society is kamadhenu. It gives you, but you must also give it back, otherwise it won't exist, because it is only a concept. You can destroy that concept or you can promote that concept. You must sustain that concept. You cannot rob that concept. That is social capital. How this social capital works in India, with particular reference to Tirupur, it has been at page 219 of the book which has been given to you. I am quoting from the World Bank about Tirupur. It is the Gowndar community there which took the lead. They were the cotton growers, because the soil is black soil. It grew cotton, they grew cotton. From cotton they found they could easily do ginning. Then they went into cotton ginning. Then they found they could do spinning. They went into spinning. And then they thought they could do weaving. They went into weaving. Then they found they could do knitting. They went into knitting. In 25 years, a community transformed itself without any kind of assistance from government. Only through communitarian competition within, it produced a huge entrepreneurial movement. That is the case with 2,800 industrial clusters in this country. And they became the knitting center of the world. It is one of the biggest knitting centers, exporting almost $3 billion worth knitwear garments. And one chari from Boston University came and studied it, because he belonged to Tamil Nadu, he knew about it. And when he wanted to study, the nearby educational institutions did not think of studying it. It is Boston group which came and studied, and the nearby educational institutions provided them facility, making them stay, giving them transport, because people are coming from Boston. But you never thought of studying it yourself. Anyhow, this chari study was quoted by the World Bank in the World Development Report 2001. The mother of the Gowndar household was the key, not only in unwaged reproductive labor, but also in marketing household products. Moreover, this she seems to have controlled the family earnings to secure commodities necessary to reproduce the family. The implications that women hold purse strings of rural Gowndar households recurs in gendered self-perceptions of community Gowndar men today, especially in the way self-made men speak of accessing family savings from their mothers. Repeatedly, I must have related with at least 30-40 important knitwear manufacturers there. All of them said, my seed capital came from my mother. It is not from venture capitalists, not no angel investor. Narayan Murthy came from wife. In fact, Tata Consultancy, TCS says that it is our salary which became savings and promoted Infosys. And the World Development Report 2001 speaks of how the credit rotation from within the Gowndar community promoted the Tirupur as a knitwear center. This is not just an anecdote. This is the model. So this is possible because of social capital. You have to sustain social capital. You cannot sustain, destroy social capital through individualism and look for social capital and try to create it through Lions Club. It's not possible. Everybody in Lions Club wants to be a visible member to attract business opportunities. It is not to contribute to someone. It is to take. I'm not meaning that they are not doing service work, but it is in the sense of how to give it to the other member. No, they want to give it to the society so that no, they are recognized as discharging their social obligations. That's a different thing. But as a society, it cannot produce the same result as a community can produce. So community is social capital. You cannot form communities by law. You cannot form families by law. This is the most important lesson we get out of the whole thing, that the business model in India is based on family and social capital. 97.5% of the Indian businesses are owned by families. Even in the Sensex companies, remove the public sector undertakings, except two companies, all other companies are family owned. Almost all the businesses in Germany are family owned. Invariably, all corporations in Korea, Taiwan, Japan are family owned. But your teaching is against family ownership and you are going to get employed there. See the contradiction between the managers and the owners. You have no respect for the owners because of your education. You must align the education system as to how family control and professional management can exist together. It has been a fantastic success. But your management education is based on social engineering, individualism, market, market society, and not market economics. So German doesn't have a management institute. Japan doesn't have a management institute. Because for them, management is the institute. Industry is technology. So we must not get glued to the Anglo-Saxon model. We must widen our horizon. There are areas where we may have to take from the Anglo-Saxon input. We have to take from Germany, we have to take from Japan, because we share a very large traditional base of behavior which transforms and transmutes into economic behavior, commercial behavior. This is the foundation for how the Indian business, economic, financial and management model and behavior model is different, and rest we will take it in the next class. Thank you very much. And I am very happy. Today is a very tough day. It integrates sociology, politics, theocracy, anthropology, market economics, communism and social capital. You can understand it's a very wide area, and I was happily surprised that all of you are very keenly interested in following today. Thank you very much.
Just one announcement before the questions. Next Friday, Gurumurthy ji has agreed to give an open session that will be in Thane in a big auditorium with about 1000 people. Mostly the professionals will be attending, but anyone who is interested can attend it. It will be immediately after our session at 8 o'clock in the evening. So any questions? You're open.
If you are, what are you saying?
Okay, I have a small question. You have referred to about this divine right.
Divine right.
Divine right. In India also we say Vishnu. I mean, king is a incarnation of Vishnu.
Yes.
Or so. Is it the same? Or
even God's rights are limited. That's what we say. Okay. You cannot destroy forest and build temples in India. You know, in our place, I am from a village, I can understand it much better than most of you. If we have to cut a tree, we have to take permission from the tree. We have to write a letter saying we need to uproot you. Please give us permission. And then we have to hang it around the tree and wait for 15 days. If nothing wrong happens, nobody falls ill, no bad news comes, then the tree has given permission. So you must understand, you must risk all this to cut the tree. You know, in our house in Chennai, we bought a house in 1977 where almost at it was 60 feet by 120 feet broad, I mean two ground area, in which there is a neem tree which is about 15 feet from one side of the plot. And so we had to rebuild the house. The entire planning was as to how to preserve the tree and build the house, because we are not allowed to cut neem trees. You may be the owner of the plot, but that part is owned by the tree. This is what has saved India, but this is not what we are educated on. You can come to my house and see. Paris has come to my house, and I don't know who else has come. That whole house was devised to grow the tree. We lost something like 45 square feet for the tree to be there.
And one more question. You made a reference that the language was not the bond in case of France and Italy and so on. Then what could be the bond? Because we understand that language is a prime bond to keep those countries.
Language safe. Became the bond. See, there were dialects. Like there are 900 dialects in this country, local languages. Tulu is there. Konkani is there. These are all languages. But Marathi language became the identity of Maharashtra. It was a very large population. But in France, just 2.5% of the people spoke the French language as we know today, when France was formed. It is only the mighty people who had large armies, who had arms, they shaped a society into a nation. This is what Hofbaum says. It was not with the consent of the people, as Locke would say. It is after collectivizing them and saying, give me consent, then they have to give consent. That is how consent was obtained.
Sir, what is the I would like to know how to form corporations, sir. In Japan, you told that family-based corporations are very better. In India, if you want to form corporations and do some business, what?
Corporations are formed by families.
Only families.
The individual may form the corporation. The family only supports him. Okay, thank you.